for the word of God and for the testimony of Jesus Christ, one and the same. And it's a conjunction, so that means it's a continuation of the same thought. You're obeying the word of God is the testimony of Jesus Christ, and it's going to bring trouble. I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day. What's today?
Lord's day.
First day of the week. And I heard behind me a great voice as of trumpet. In other words, it was loud. Very loud voice. Loud. Not shh. I don't see John going shh. Come on, it hurts my ears. Just tone it down a little bit. Saying, I am Alpha and Omega. Beginning, the end, first and the last. And what you see, write in a book. John, write it down. And send it to the seven churches. Okay, church, you're naming the name of Christ right here. For the number of weeks that we've been doing that, God himself cared enough about your soul to send you these letters. How have you treated them? You get all warm and fuzzy on Sunday, and then that's it. Well, he knows your works. He saw where he said, you need to sit down and I need to talk to you, and you refused to do it because the cares of this world was more pressing on you. Understand, we don't serve a convenient God. He doesn't tell you, get all your little duckies in a row and then sit down with your nice little quiet time with me and we'll have a campfire powwow. He will come to you in your most upside down time and say, sit, boo-boo. It's like loving somebody back that loves you. That's easy. It's easy to agape. But where there is no agape, and for you to extend agape, that's pretty tough. It goes against the grain and it takes the cross to get it done. So what do you think he's going to put in front of your face?
That we are weak and we'll see you can talk to
him. I didn't hear it.
Lots of weeds to pull. Weeds,
so you can sit and talk to him. We just had this conversation.
Under the seven churches, who in here is Ephesus, Smyrna, Pergamos, Thyatira, Sardis, Philadelphia, Laodicea? And I turned to see the voice that spoke to me. And being turned, I saw seven golden lampstands. And in the midst of the seven golden lampstands, one likened to the Son of Man, clothed with a garment down to the foot, and girth about the paps with a golden girdle. His head and his hair were white like wool and white as snow. In other words, this is speaking of ultimate majesty and authority. And his eyes were as a flame of fire. In other words, his eyes, his word will penetrate you. Unless you have seared your conscience and your heart and it's stone dead cold. They will burn because the Holy Spirit is fire. And he will purge. Here, John, for this is the first time. John's experiencing something with his Savior that he hasn't experienced. And and his feet like unto fine brass. Brass always speaks of judgment. As if they burned in a furnace. And his voice was as the sound of many waters. Speaking of, you ever been beside, you know, of course, Smoky Mountains has been, I spent a lot of time there. And you can take a walk, most time it's way back in. You can stand beside a trickling brook, or you can stand beside a brook of many waters, which is what? It's a sound of power and strength. It roars. I mean, we've pretty much all been there. And what does it do? It just, you're like a deer in the headlights. You're just, wow. Oh. Well, this is what John was experiencing. And he had in his right hand seven stars, which is the seven churches, which he explains here in a minute. And out of his mouth went a sharp two-edged sword. In other words, the word of God. And his countenance was as the sun shone in his strength. You ever try to stare at the sun? Especially this time of year? Yeah, it's pretty tough. The power of that created thing. You just couldn't. So this is what John was experiencing. And when I saw him, I fell at his feet as dead. Now, I've heard the clowns in the pulpit tell the goats, this was John's act of reverential fear to Jesus. No.
He's scared to death.
He was seeing the babe of Bethlehem grown up and a picture of judgment, and it literally terrified him. But he says what?
Fear not.
If you're absolutely clean before him, it's kind of like Moses. That's why you have a picture way back then, thousands of years before. The people that got left in the wilderness. No, Moses, you go talk to God. You just tell us what he says, and then we'll just listen to you. Moses wasn't fearful talking to God. So John fell at his feet as though dead, because the sight scared him to death, and he laid his right hand upon me. Right hand.
Right hand.
The hand of authority, the hand of power, saying, fear not, John, I'm the first and the last. I am he who lives and was dead, and behold, I am alive forevermore. Amen. And I have the keys of hell and of death. Do you not find that interesting? Out of all the things in the revealing book of Revelation, that it starts out with what kind of revelation? Don't you think that he would have said, you know, I got the keys of heaven and the kingdom? He didn't say that. That doesn't sound very encouraging. First book, I have the keys of hell and death. What does that mean? I have all authority over every soul of man. Now, does this line up what Jesus said to the disciples earlier in his training session about Don't fear the one that can kill your body. Fear the one who has power after he has killed to cast your soul into hell. Mm-hmm. Yes, I say, fear him. So, should it be surprising then that he has this in the Revelation book of Jesus Christ?
No, it shouldn't.
Shouldn't. Write the things, and right here you have the key to the book of Revelation. John, I'm telling you, write the things which you have seen, past. I want you to write the things which are present. And I want you to write the things which will be future. Past, present, future. The chronological book of the book of Revelation. And if your leader deviates from the chronological order of this book in any kind of teaching, this is who he is. It's the last book. And it's there as the last witness to anything that anybody wants to teach. If you don't line up here, power flush. Write the things which you have seen. Write the things which are. Write the things which will be. And the mystery of the seven stars which you saw in my right hand, and the seven golden lampstands, the seven stars of the angels, or the messengers of the seven churches. Now, this Bible here has the pastor of the seven churches, which I don't agree with, because some of the pastors of these churches were not too good. So why would I want to listen to a spiritually adulterated leader of a church? The seven stars are the angels of the seven churches, and the seven lampstands which you saw are the seven churches. In other words, I'm fixing to give you the entirety of the church ages. Beginning to end. You know what I said? I'm Alpha. I'm Omega. What's fixing to happen, here is an age of the church. I'm not going to give you the time frame, but you'll see it through its characteristics. And we, like no other generation, have the knowledge to look back on all of its history and to see exactly where we are today right here at the end of the age. See, this plan, we're just coming to the end of the age. This earth is never going away. It's going to experience a final refinement with fire and we step into eternity. But it's still going to be here. Either that or God's a liar where he said that as long as heaven and earth are, my words will always be. Is his word somehow or another out there going to cease to exist? Mm-hmm. So, the key, we've seen what? Key of David, key of knowledge, key of hell and death. Key of the pit, Revelation 9 and Revelation 20. Revelation 9 and 1, if you want to find Revelation 20, put your finger in there, that way we can... flip to them readily. 9:1-2. And the fifth angel sounded, and I saw a star fall from heaven unto the earth. Somebody turn to Luke 10, verse 18, and read it. Out loud, please, not just. Luke 10, verse 18.
And he said unto them, I beheld Satan as lightning fall from heaven.
So what are we seeing here? And the fifth angel sounded, and I saw a star fall from heaven unto the earth, and to him was given the key of the bottomless pit. So we have an angel of God doing what?
Falling.
No. What does it say? I saw a star fall from heaven to the earth, and to him, by this fifth angel sounding, was given the key of the bottomless pit.
Satan was given the key.
Who held the key?
Satan.
No.
He was an angel.
Christ holds the key.
Correct.
But it was given to him.
Oh. And he
went for a time being, he was given control.
How do we know that? Second verse. And he, Satan, opened the bottomless pit. So here again, the key has to do with all authority. Satan can only do
what he's allowed to do.
What he's allowed to do, what keys he is given in order to function with. Like what you were talking about, a door. The only door that you can access by a key is the key given for that door. Right? So here, an angel gives Satan a key, and he opens the bottomless pit, and there arose smoke out of the pit as smoke of a great furnace, and the sun and the air were darkened by reason of the smoke of the pit. Smoke does what?
Obscure.
You ever been in a forest fire or something that's burning on the interstate and drove through just a massive amount of smoke? What? This smoke rose up. What does it say? Where is it? It's a symbol of blinding delusion. Satan is the author of confusion. Satan is nothing but delusion and deception. Okay? So this key to this pit, and then in chapter 20, I saw an angel come down from heaven. In other words, this right here continues a thought or shows us a thought that even the angels in heaven have a plan, they have a responsibility, they have a race, they have a duty, they have a destiny. They do not break rank. They do what they were created to do. Hello, hello, hello. And they don't break ranks. They don't. You see a characteristic, what we saw, I think it was last week, of the saints, us in Joel. They don't break rank. In other words, when you get there, it's because you overcame here and you did here what you're going to do there when you come back. You passed the test. This is your training ground. This is your testing ground. It's your proving ground. You don't pass here, there is no there. I saw an angel come down from heaven having the key of the bottomless pit, and a great chain in his hand. Now, in this instance, the angel doesn't give the key to Satan. He opens the same pit. So obviously, Whenever Satan was given the key earlier, the key was taken back. And a great chain in his hand, and he laid hold on the dragon, that old serpent which is the devil, Satan, and bound him 1,000 years, and cast him into the bottomless pit, and shut him up, and set a seal upon him that he should deceive the nations no more till 1,000 years should be fulfilled, and after that he must be loosed a little season. The kingdom age, Satan and all of his cohorts are bound. And I don't think we're going to get, we're not going to get to that today. We'll cross that bridge when we get there. But here again, Satan's MO is what? Deceiving the nations. Okay. Back to verse 8 in chapter 3 of Philadelphia. I know your works. Sixth time we've seen it. 6 out of 6 now. I know what you're doing. Know what you're thinking. You're not fooling me. You may have everybody around you fooled, but you ain't fooling me. Behold, I have set before you an open door, and no man can shut it. Here it's repeated again. So, do you think Philadelphians believe God? Now, they're coming out of the hills of what church era? What church age?
Sardis.
Which was what?
Defiled.
Dead and dying. Is that a huge transition from dead and dying to absolute, complete, and total belief? All it takes is decreeing a thing and it'll be a stat. All you got to do is decide, okay, that's what happened. I know it was almost 2,000 years ago. I wasn't there. But this book says, blessed is he who believes and has not seen. I'm tired of the old man. I'm tired of living in defeat. I'm tired. All it takes is a decision to believe. And based on that act, you walk in victory. I know your works. Behold, I have set before you an open door. So, the greatest missionary push of the entire church age begins. And it's through this church age, 1750 to 1900, that by the next part of the verse says you have a little strength. These few in number individuals begin going through the entire planet. This little strength, few in number. So how does that apply to us? If you're going to be without rebuke by Jesus Christ, you're going to be few in number. You're going to be 2 or 3 or 4 or 5. I wish I could tell you something different, but I can't. That's the way it is. It's where we are. You have a little strength and have kept my word and have not denied my name. So here we have a connection. Positive, negative, few in number, kept my word, denied my name, keeping his commands, and not denying his name is one and the same. And I skipped something here. What was it? Open door. So we'll back up. Go to Matthew 25.
The open door of verse 8.
Mm-hmm.
Of Revelation.
Yes.
He's opened the door, don't make sense.
25:6.
Matthew 25. Known as the parable of the 10 virgins. Since the topic is virgins, this has to do with the bride. What has to do with the bride? The bride of Christ. So this is speaking to the church. It's not speaking to lost folks. It's speaking to born again folks. Jesus, as he did numerous times, says, then shall the kingdom of heaven be like unto 10. Okay? Verse 1. Likened unto 10 virgins, which took their lamps and went forth to meet the bridegroom. So that means that all of these virgins had lamps. They had lamps burning, and they had lamps with oil. Oil being symbolic, through we know through the Hebrew scriptures, symbol of the Holy Spirit. So all of these people were born again. You can't have a lamp to start with, and you can't have a lamp burning if you're not filled with the Holy Spirit.
Which is the oil.
Which is the oil. Five of them were wise. Five were foolish. Jesus did this a lot, talking about wise and foolish. They who were foolish took their lamps and took no oil with them. In other words, they began a journey of living outside the power of the Holy Spirit. I can do this. They have these early victories. They have these early manifestations of power. What happens? Well, the cross isn't focused anymore. See, it's far more dangerous in times of prosperity and successful living to fall than it is into the depths of despair. So these foolish ones took their eye, I can do it, I'm good to go. But the wise took oil in their vessels with their lamps. In other words, their eyes were constantly focused on the victory of grace at the cross. And no, where sin did abound, grace did much more abound. No. Old man's dead. No. I walk as he walked. I'm completely perfected. I'm completely grown up. I'm completely mature. While the bridegroom tarried, being Jesus Christ, they all slumbered and slept. This is not really a negative insinuation. It's just basically talking about same category. You know, they were all in church, one beside each other. But such it is with the power of the Holy Spirit, when he's in one and not in the other, one gets a revelation that the other one is completely and totally blind to, and you couldn't explain it to him with 10,000 words. Why? Because the Spirit of truth is gone. Hello. He's gone. As Ephesus, he left. He removed himself. And at midnight, there was a cry made, a call. In other words, a call went out. Something I've been doing for a number of years. We've been in midnight. There's been a call going out. Behold, he's coming. He's coming very soon. Don't believe the lie about you're not going to know it. He's just going to poof, pop, and it's done. Unto those that look for him will he come a second time. Look, that is a continuous present tense verb. They're not looking to the left. They're not looking to the right. Everything that they see out on the horizon is lined up with Scripture. They understand it according to Scripture. They're right on target, and they understand that trumpets is it. So this cry went out, and behold, the bridegroom cometh. Go you out to meet him. Then all those virgins arose and trimmed their lamps. In other words, trim the wicks. You know, we did that one day in here. It's interesting that lamp in there, it had a flicker, but the flicker just wasn't right, was it? Maybe we need to trim it. Wonder how we do that. Very carefully, we found out. You don't just look at it. Careful observance. All those virgins rose and trimmed their lamps. Interesting, that's something they had to do. And the foolish said to the wise, give us of your oil, for our lamps are gone out, which is typical. I want your blessing, but I don't want to do what it takes to get the blessing. I want what you're got, but I don't really want to die to self. I like the Jesus thing, but yeah, taking up my cross every day. I just want to be blessed. So let me go into your house and say the Lord bless you. Oh, blessings, 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 blessings. So here's the foolish. They're going to find out it's too late. But the wise answered, saying, no. Not getting my oil. In other words, sorry, you can't share the Holy Spirit. You got him or you don't. You got him or you don't. What's the bottom line of the parable of 10 virgins? If he has departed from you, you are not getting in. And he does depart. You can sit there and tell yourself a lie 24/7, but it does not line up with the witness of the Word of God that is holy and true. Lest there be not enough for us and you, but go and rather to those who sell and buy for yourselves. And while they went to buy, the bridegroom came, and they who were ready went in with him to the marriage, and the door was shut. Now, if you hold that place there and you turn over to Hebrews chapter 3, one another daily. How often?
Every day.
Daily. You know, I know a bunch of you are Facebook and text maniacs in here. Or how many times do you use that to exhort one another daily? Exhort one another daily about what? Well, let's see. Well, you actually have to go back. We're going to go forward so you can go back. Exhort one another daily while it is called today. What did we just read over here? They who were ready went in with him to the marriage, and the door was shut. There will come a time when it is too late. There are already, for some out there, it's too late according to Hebrews chapter 6. They have apostatized themselves. They have crossed a point of no return, and the Bible says it is impossible to renew them again to repentance. There are those already out there. It's too late. They're done. The door is shut.
That was where?
You can't
Hebrews 6. Okay. But this is Hebrews 3. While it's called today, in other words, don't deceive yourself, lest any of you be hardened through the deceitfulness of sin. How do you get hard-hearted?
Sinning.
Continuing to sin. What is sin? Missing the mark. What's the mark? You have the written and you have the spirit. And we're going to see that here in just a second. Very, very interesting. For we are made partakers of Christ. Did you catch that? That word, partakers. Sharers in. We are made sharers of Christ. There is that word that Baptists especially hate and they ignore completely. If automatically classifies this as a conditional promise, as every promise of God is conditional. If we hold the beginning of our confidence. What is the beginning of our confidence as believers? When does that happen?
Salvation.
When you truly get born again, you begin a race. A race that must be overcoming and endure to the end. The end, not the beginning, the end. I'm the Alpha and the Omega. Steadfast unto the end. While it is said today, what are you getting dealt with today? What is the Holy Spirit burning? I mean, when a word went out or a word was said, it was just like, no. What are you doing with it? Are you just go away, go away, go away. If I write something else down, it'll go away. I won't. While it is said today, right now, this hour, if you will hear his voice, harden not your hearts as in the provocation. And this goes back to reference to Numbers 14. Because that's the only scripture they could teach from. And this was some 30 years after the cross when Hebrews was penned. So how do you harden your heart? Not obeying what you hear. That's how it comes about. That's the danger. You want to see how that plays out? Go back and read Numbers chapter 14. It's not a pretty picture. These things were written aforetime for our admonition and warning. Don't do what they did wrong. Do what they did right. Today, for some when they heard did provoke. Ooh. Whoa, 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 whoa. Here comes the x-ray again. Who in here, who out there have heard? You heard, you understood. But God's calling that provoking him. Wow. Mm. For some, when they heard, did provoke. Howbeit, not all who came out of Egypt by Moses, but with whom was he grieved 40 years? Was it not with those who had sinned, whose carcasses fell in the wilderness, and to whom swore he that they would not enter into his rest, but to those who believed not? In other words, Joshua and Caleb entered in. Those who refused to believe time and time and time again. Doesn't mean it's the same circumstance. It wasn't. It was different circumstances, but it was the same heart dealing with unbelief. They just refused to believe that God meant what he said and said what he meant. It's that simple. And this was a time of winking. Ooh. So we should see that they could not enter in because of unbelief. Be ye perfect, even as your Father in heaven is perfect, without spot, without wrinkle. Walk as he walked. Be as he is. Love as I have loved you. You can't do that without what happened at the cross. You cannot love another human being on this planet the way Christ loved us without that power. You can't get it done. And I know some of you think, well, that's pretty harsh and cold telling that young man, what are you sticking your nose over here in my business for? You know, I bet if you dug really hard in the Gospels, you'd find Jesus using the same terminology but different words. Because that's what that young man needed. If you really know me, you know me. I'm really a man of many emotions. What are you laughing at back there, Kim?
Abby.
Oh. Well, I'm glad you're focused. If you will hear his voice. Genesis 7. What are you going all the way back over there for? Well, he's the beginning, isn't he?
Hold your place, because we're coming back then.
What's Genesis? The beginning. First of Tishir. Yes.
Genesis
no.
7 on page 7.
No. Verses 1 through 16. And the Lord said unto Noah, come you and all your house into the ark, for you have I seen righteous before me in this generation. So, can God say that about you? Can he? As the days of Noah, here's an aspect of the days of Noah. So it will be when I come. I mean, literally, if we took a study and did all of the characteristics and aspects of the days of Noah and Lot, it'd probably take a year. I'm serious. It's a deep well that is almost never ending. Because just when you get to the point to where you think that you've got all that can be revealed, guess what happens? Holy Spirit shows up and went, uh-uh, here's another one. Of every clean beast you shall take to you by sevens. the male and female of the beasts that are not clean by two, and the male and his female. Of the fowls also of the air by sevens, the male and the female, to keep seed alive upon the face of all the earth. Now, for those of you, and I'm not going to spend a whole lot of time here, but Jesus Christ said, as the days of Noah shall be my coming, right? He said that. So for you who want to refute, you want to believe a certain thing so that you don't have to adhere to a certain standard.
Right.
No man knows the hour or the day, which we've already seen that if you will not watch, you will not know what hour I come. So the key, since Revelation is the revelation of Jesus, it's the complete and total picture that you take that and then, the puzzle, it fits. How many of you work a puzzle and you just get so excited because you find a piece towards the end that fits?
Oh, yeah. I'm on it.
For yet 7 days, Noah, that's allegorical. It's symbolic. No. Really? You wouldn't believe the amount of lies over the years I've heard people tell themselves to tell me of refuting something that was said to them because of a heart of unbelief. So you couldn't do nothing for the children of Israel that was left in the wilderness to die. You couldn't do anything with them. You can't do anything with a heart of unbelief. If God Himself could not convert, hello, who are you? That's why, don't argue. You don't get in heated debates. Okay. Just very gently, quietly, close the book.
He couldn't convince them with mass miracles.
No.
Like, 10 plagues, deliverance from the Egyptians in the Red Sea, water when there was no water, food when there was no food, quail when there was no... You just think about all the miracles that happen. Hey, go in there, I'll give you the country. No, he won't. They're too big. So, who are we? It's not like we're going to start parting the Red Sea, you know.
How much water do you think it would take for millions of people and their critters? Just water.
It wasn't a trickle out of a...
How many gallons a day do you put down your gullet?
I think people settle themselves on the children's story of Noah. They think they know, but they don't go back and read the adult version, which is Jonah. Same with Jonah.
Yeah. Well, you don't counterfeit $1 bills. This is extremely important for our generation. So, see, we in 1900 we started Laodicea. Okay? We're not at the beginning of Laodicea. We're at the bumper. We're at the exhaust pipe that really stinks. We'll get there. For yet 7 days, Noah, and I will cause it to rain upon the earth 40 days and 40 nights. Noah was completely clueless when the rains were going to start, right?
How long they were going to last.
Now, he didn't know the hour of the day, since the day starts at sunset to sunset. So in our terminology, it's 2 days, but it's 24 hours. Right?
Right?
Same way with Feast of Trumpets. It's a 24-hour day, but it starts at sunset the day before. Concludes at sunset the next day. So in a 24-hour period, and a day here and a day there, you don't know the hour or the day. Now, heart of unbelief, you can't argue that with anybody. If it is the two or three or the four or five berries, they will hear those words come out of your mouth and it will be, my goodness. Not, now, no man knows the hour of the day. That's what the Bible says. That's what the Pharisees beat Jesus up with the scrolls.
Yeah, everyone already had the newsflash too. That's all they talked about. How does he know the times?
Tribe of Issachar. They understood the times and the seasons.
What was it a few years ago, too, you said you struggled with one will be left in the field, one because it's Israel's time, not...
Right. Yeah.
One will be taken.
Wait a minute. That's a Sabbath no work day. Why are they in the field working? Well, it's because this entire planet's on a different time zone. Where it's sunset one place, it's not sunset in another. See? So there's no, whether you understand, there's no contradiction in Scripture. You may not have the revelation of the truth yet, but it's not wrong. And if you want the revelation, then you're going to have to dig and dig deep. Because you're faithful over a little, but you're in charge much. You're not faithful over the little, you don't get the much. You don't get it. 7 days, I will cause it to rain upon the earth 40 days and 40 nights. And Noah did according unto all that the Lord commanded him. And Noah was 600 years old when the flood of the waters was upon the earth. And Noah went in, his sons, his wife, his sons' wives with him, into the ark because of the waters of the flood. Now, if you turn over to Hebrews 11, 7, somebody turn there and read that.
By faith Noah, being warned of God of things not seen as yet, moved with fear, prepared an ark to the saving of his house, by the which he condemned the world and became heir of the righteousness which is by faith.
Do you understand that? As the days of Noah. In other words, you believers should be acting, walking, and talking, doing just as Noah. Are you? What does it say again? Read it again, Martha.
The whole thing.
Yes.
By faith, Noah, being warned of God...
Stop. What's the first characteristic?
By faith.
Why? Because it's impossible to please God without it. And whatever's not of faith is sin.
Right.
And if you got sin on you, it's a blot. It's a spot. It's a wrinkle. It's not perfection. And I'm not talking about sinless perfection, because sinless perfection is you never sinning. The courts of heaven imputes sin to you when you know. It's still sin whether you know it or not, but once you know it, it goes over in the grounds of iniquity if you continue to do it. So he what? By faith?
Being warned of God of things not seen as yet.
Stop. You seen the rapture yet?
Mm-mm. No. But he prepared.
You seen the refining, purifying, and making white? Yeah, you know. It's been going on a while. I forget what that was. Was it Dollywood? Them different holes up there, that glass maker thing where we got that lamp? Glory hole.
Yeah.
The one that was the hottest.
This is a glory hole.
I say, is anybody around here I can preach to? Glory hole. Hey, you want to hear? I'll tell you about a glory hole. I used to embarrass Donna.
Used to?
Yeah. She's overcome a lot. Now, for the most part, she's my cheering section. She won't even push me in front of him to sick somebody. She goes herself. No, you tell him. You talk to him. Glory hole. It was the hottest of the bunch. I think there was three, wasn't there? Yeah, there was three.
Yeah, there were three.
I don't remember the others. Just the glory hole. Okay.
Moved with fear. Prepared an ark to the saving of his house.
Stop. You preparing your ark? Are you? Are you just coming here and having a good time? Oh, it's great fellowship. Oh, it's good food. Oh. We don't live by physical bread. And I don't take lightly what we do here on Saturday evenings. That's a huge warning about salt. You lose your savor, you lose the saltiness, you're thrown out. You may not need that reminder every week, but this old boy wants it. Just as God put that rainbow up in the sky for himself to remember his covenant, I need to remember every week. As much as a good meal to sit down is a godly thing, so is eating this.
By the which he condemned the world and became heir of the righteousness which is by faith.
How did Noah condemn the world? You catch that? Without opening his mouth, by the way. How did he do that?
By preparing. By being righteous.
Obeying.
In his actions.
His life. That was totally, completely peculiar and opposite to what everybody else was doing. How many people in the multiplied millions of churchgoers think are doing what we're doing this morning? Two or three. Four or five. So Noah was moved with, in other words, Noah believed what God said. Of the clean beasts and the beasts that are not clean and the fowls and everything that creeps upon the earth. There went in two and two unto Noah, into the ark. Noah, think about that. Noah didn't have anything to do with them animals showing up. Because God is in control of all of his creation. Okay, Noah, I'm going to get them to the ark. You get them in there. Think about that. Think about that next time you become afraid of a storm. If thunder and lightning is in the throne room and it's voices speaking, and when you read in Revelation when things begin to fly from the angels sent, that's their assignment, it speaks again. Thunderings and lightnings. You best, instead of fearing thundering lightning, what are you saying? What are you saying to me? Because you're a personal God of covenant. It came to pass, imagine that, his word is holy and true. It came to pass after 7 days that the waters of the flood were upon the earth. You missed the Feast of Trumpets and the rapture. You're going to know that the waters come upon the earth, but it's too late for you. And in the 600th year of Noah's life, in the second month, the 17th day of the month, the same day were all the fountains of the great deep broken up, and the windows of heaven were open. And the rain was upon the earth 40 days and 40 nights. The literal Hebrew of that reads, and there was violent rain. I want you to think about as the days of Noah. There's places in this nation and world right now has seen some violent rain, but they haven't seen anything yet of what is going to happen.
My brother and I were just talking about that because, you know, he's in Oklahoma and they've had some rain. It's usually a drought place. And in a couple of towns right there, they received 9 inches of rain in an hour. And so I'm sitting here and I'm going, 9 inches, that's a lot of rain. But the waters are already gone, you know, a few days later. But enough to keep the whole earth wet, flooded. For 40 days, just how fast it must have come and how much there was.
I mean, it was so to where the people that were alive were pretty much drowned in a nano. Mm-hmm. They didn't have it, and it's the same scenario. When that blows, the Antichrist immediately is coming to power. And this planet, as humans know it today, is changed. Instantly, the authority of everything is going to change in a nanosecond. Why would we be surprised of extremes of drought and flood? It says it in Deuteronomy 28. It's nothing more than holy and true. His words are true. Whether you believe them or not, they're coming to pass. You can call it global warming. You can come up with your own God to explain what's happening other than the one true God of what he said. In the selfsame day, Noah entered Shem, Ham, and Japheth, the sons of Noah, Noah's wife, and the three wives of his son, and them into the ark. They and every beast after his kind, and all the cattle after their kind, and every creeping thing that creeps upon the earth. Every creeping thing, Kiami. They was in bed with Noah. Crawling on his nose when he woke up in the morning.
Hey, little fella. Good morning.
And now women of faith run around stomping. Kill it, kill it! Really? And this is a new and better covenant? Snakes? Really? Corn snakes? Poor little fella. It's a copperhead. No, it was a copperhead. I promise you, it was a copperhead.
Corn snake.
There's a spiritual lesson in that somewhere.
The appearance of evil will get you dead.
Good one.
The appearance of evil.
And they went into the ark, two and two in all flesh, wherein is the breath of life. God supernaturally intervened in the instincts of all these animals and put them there. Did something that never been done before. Hello, there's another one. They just pop up everywhere, almost every other sentence. And they went in, male and female of all flesh. And this is so cool. As God had commanded him, and the Lord shut him in. God, Lord. Two different names for God. God commanded, Elohim. The Lord shut him in, Jehovah. God commanded, Jehovah ensures. Gonna be okay. One little sentence is all it is, but I don't know if you can grasp the gravity of that one half verse. The many names of God, and they all speak very loudly. You want 10 to your unruly child, please? So, here's another aspect of the days of Noah. This right here in days long ago, as in the days of Noah, for us when Jesus spoke it almost 2,000 years ago. But right here, you have the perfect picture of those who are truly in Christ and the security that's there in Jehovah. God commands, Jehovah ensures. Mm. He doesn't change. Man does not live by bread alone.
And again, how you said that if God cannot convince, how can you? You've been making fun of this guy for 600 years, or 100 years did it take to build the ark? Something like that.
120.
Yeah. And then all of a sudden at the end of it, he gets it built and animals just start randomly walking up. And nobody else, you know what? Okay. You've been making fun of a guy for 120 years. Because you saw, and then all of a sudden what he said, okay.
Don't realize that's a sign of Noah's time.
Right.
That was manifested.
Now.
Was it safe for us?
Exactly. What you were saying is God can't convince somebody to change. How are you? Who are you? Yeah. These people saw these animals walking by, going up, jumping in this ark, and Noah just like, okay, we got
to. That was against their character.
In my ignorance, I always thought Noah gathered the animals.
It wasn't until
Well, think about the animals' different
personality.
Topography,
yeah.
Requirements.
Right.
There had to be some supernatural transplanting where some of them were. Mm-hmm. And that's where I've heard the argument, well, that's all allegory. It's impossible for an elephant on this continent to get to the other continent. He didn't swim the ocean. See, when you try to understand God outside a supernatural realm, then you don't really believe He controls the universe, that He is a creator.
Well, but if you believe He created all these animals and put them in their place, why would you not believe that He could put them in their place yet again?
Mm-hmm. Right.
And yet again, why would you not believe that the Son of God would come, die, bury, rise again, and sits?
On the throne.
As the days of Noah. So you have scoffers who scoff then.
Yes.
You have scoffers who scoff today. And you want to throw this all away and say none of it applies? Let's just make a nice, petty children's story out of it.
Mm.
Leaders removing the key of knowledge. Mm. The true God. Well, let's carve out one that we can easily serve. We don't have to die to Him.
Madeline O'Hare. You know, it's just one person. She'll never get it done. It's just one person behind that pulpit. Nobody's going to believe. You know, just one person.
But it shows
the heart.
Laodicea. Yeah. If that would have been, it didn't happen in Philadelphia.
Mm-mm. But it was tried.
Yeah, it was tried.
A couple of years ago when you gave us those Noah pictures, the one thing that stuck with me was you said everybody probably thought they could get on the ark when it started happening.
Mm-hmm.
They didn't think, yeah. Well, if this God is really true, he'll let me in. Like I said, days of Noah, I mean, we could camp out here for a long time, almost as long as we've been on seven churches, probably. We may not get through Laodicea until Tabernacles. I don't know. We're going to stop right there.
And what hits me is that Methuselah, who happened to die at that time, because that's when he died,
mm-hmm.
when the flood came, was Enoch's son. And he had seen Enoch walk with God, and then he was not, because he had walked with God. And still he didn't even get on the ark.
An evil heart of unbelief. That's a powerful, powerful thing. But it's a warning to us. Just as if you really want to find the truth, you'll find it. You'll make time to find it. That's really all the 32 years this year of farming, and that's been my greatest reward and motivator to suck up. Do whatever needs to be done, because I got all winter to do nothing but eat. I'd rather do that as anything. An occasional walk with my wife.
More than occasional.
But see, God's rewarding us now with that. But there wasn't a whole lot of time in the beginning. Mm-hmm. I had to be faithful over little. I had to start somewhere. Then God multiplied the time according to his word, because he's holy and true. Do you turn the light switch off when you leave the room? Or you leave it burning when nobody's there? Faithful over little. See, people, they want all the, give me. It's little foxes that spoil the mind.
And one of the things that, you know, we've stayed in the camper for a very long time. But one thing that I have
fixing to get longer.
But one thing that I learned is to turn the water off. Conserve that water. Faithful over a little. It just amazes me. You know, you turn the faucet on in the kitchen and you're washing one little utensil at a time like this underneath that water. Why don't I fill it up just a little bit and wash them all at once and put them all over here and then rinse them off real quick? You know, that's how I had to do
it. It is astounding how fast you go through 40 gallons of water when that is your total and complete source.
Mm-hmm.
It's amazing. It's your behavior.
Or how quick you drink up 12 gallons of water, cooking and whatnot.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Because, I mean, you look at 40 gallon, you know, you look at a 40 gallon barrel, like, well, that's a lot of water. Yeah, not really.
Not really.
Father, we thank you for today, and we thank you for your word. We thank you that the truth does set us free when we obey it in faith. We thank you again for the victory of the cross and the grace that was instilled and empowered and revealed there through it. We thank you for the food that we're fixing to partake of, for everything in those food is sanctified when we give thanks through prayer and thanksgiving in Christ's name. Amen.